her writing in Swedish and Finnish, who very who's been an enduring influence on my thinking from the 1980s onwards on language rights, human rights, and language rights. Canadian Jim Cummings talks about languages and the common underlying proficiency, so that if you talk, if you operate in two languages like I, it's really hard sometimes to understand what he meant on this higher plane. Freire, thinking about languages and minorities in schools, particularly in England and London, where my work has taken place, cannot take place without also looking at communities and families. So if you are looking at children as well. Louis Moll, American. Looking at languages and data, and which language is about to die out, and so on. They say that there are just over 7,000 living languages in the world. But that question, so what would count as a language, is an interesting one. Is there anybody who would like to work, offer your working definition of what counts as a language? What, how do you define a language? I mean, a lot of you are multilingual, and I believe, looking at your website, I think you've done your master's in some related areas, and now looking at moving on from that into your doctoral studies. What is a language? Do you know?
Well, it is different from something like Creole, Pidgin, let's say, lingua franca as well.
Yes.
For example, something that is that has some independent status regarding its use in the society. A group accepts it as a language. Let's say a big society accepts it as a language. So
that's a lovely one. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. Any other additions? I mean, people say that old saying by Weinreich is that it's a language, it's very much if the society accepts it as a language, and only those forms of speech that have an army or a navy or a flag are often identified or accepted as a language. So Arabic, the very different forms of Arabic are often called as one language, although you don't understand if you speak this dialect and that dialect. You don't, if they're not mutually intelligible. But of course, say like Swedish, Norwegian, and Danish are always considered as different languages because they have an army and a flag and a navy. So they are very much political questions and socially constructed answers then, what counts as a language. One way of looking is that they are often comprised of waves of features that extend across language, time, geography, and social space. So there are some similarities in grammar, some similarities in vocabulary, notions of belonging to a group that perhaps inhabited one social space, one geographical space. Okay, so this question, if you don't understand how can you learn, actually it comes from last year's Global Education Monitoring Report by UNESCO, and what they said is staggering this. Your question, why am I identifying linguistic minorities as a focus for my talk, is precisely this, that 40% of the world's global population does not access education in a language that they understand. It's a stunning number, isn't it? 40% of children go to school and have to learn the school language whilst they're attending school, and they're supposedly learning to read or learning numbers or history of the place or art or music or whatever way the curriculum is organised. And we know that being taught in another language other than what they might consider their own language, and that is again a difficult term to define what would be acceptable to everybody as their own language. How could we term that? What word could we use? Could we use mother tongue? No, we can't use mother tongue for all sorts of reasons, because often mother tongue we associate the mother tongue as the first language that we learn from mother and father. And of course that changes. People forget their first languages, and the second language or third becomes more dominating and so on. And what happens when you've got two languages? Mother speaks one language, father speaks another language. You grow up having two languages. How do you then call that, those two languages? Are they mother's and father's languages? Are they family languages? Is a one word that we've often used. But then often people say that isn't quite right, because it isn't the whole of the family's language. And is it the home language? And so on. Different definitions for this own language or family language. So what we know is that in multi-ethnic societies, imposing the school's language, particularly in the context of poverty, has frequently been as a source of grievance. It creates problems, further problems. And it's this imposing dominant language that I'd like to talk here and work with you here today. That if we say that imposing English in England is a bit of an issue, what are our alternatives? And I'll come back to that in a while. So what are our alternatives? Before I begin to think about those alternatives, we have lots of global evidence that this is a serious issue, not just in England and Great Britain, but around the world. So I just picked up a couple from the report. So if we take like Iran, so 80% of grade 4 students who did not speak Farsi at home reach the basics in reading, compared with over 95% of Farsi speakers. So we have lots of studies and lots of data on learning literacy, levels of literacy around the world, and we find that the levels of literacy for those children who are learning a new language at the same time as they are learning to read is much lower. They don't learn it as fast, they don't learn it as well, and they don't maintain it. So there's a few bits of evidence there. This notion of talking about minority languages is also an issue that I do need to sort of discuss or think with you before I move on, really, is that whereas for a long time we talked about linguistic minorities, and that is the word that European Union uses, linguistic minorities in Europe. They're carefully identified whether they are indigenous languages or new languages and so on. Has also been contested that it locates it as a noun, as a kind of a static, established idea, rather than helps us to see it as a socially constructed issue. So minoritized, I think, better describes with linguistic minorities or minoritized language groups. Helps us to see that it is both socially and politically constructed. So, some minority languages and some other languages, all of them, if you think about the language repertoire of a place, some languages are glorified. They're presented as amazing, long history, rich vocabulary, interesting grammar, literature that is attached to those languages, amazing. You only just need to think about English language, what a glorified position it holds. And indeed, it does hold the most glorified position today in the world. And you can think, well, why is that? Why is that the case? I mean, and you cannot divorce Britain as a colonial power and going around the world and conquering spaces and then imposing their language to those places from the fact that it is a glorified global number one language. It's probably also glorified number one language today because the language of the United States and the advancement of technology has taken place in English. So I don't understand much of computers, but programming took place in English, am I right? So programming any sort of software had to take place in English. So various ways in which it's kind of won this position of number one language. Then other languages are very much minoritized, made to feel as a minority and not validated in many ways. In fact, they are often stigmatized. So whereas if you speak a language like French or Spanish or Italian or German, it is often seen as a good source of linguistic capital. You know, a teacher might respond to children who speak German, like, brilliant, oh, great. That's great, because when you go to secondary school, then you'll have a really easy time. That's great. All sorts of ways in which teachers might welcome those languages as a really good source of strength or linguistic capital. But of course, others don't appear in this way. In fact, many professionals have said over the years, be it speech therapist or indeed midwives. You know, when I had my first son in 1981, he was born, and I had made a conscious choice to speak to him always in Finnish because I wanted, although we lived in England then, in London, I wanted him to learn Finnish. So there I am at the maternity hospital. I've only just spoken to him in English because my first husband was there with me and our home language was English. We always spoke English together. But when he'd gone, in those days fathers were not allowed to stay in the hospital after the baby was born. When he'd gone home and I'm there, I decided, right, this is the moment then. You know, I'm going to switch and start speaking Finnish, and it. So the second day, midwife comes, how are you feeling, how are you doing, and I'm saying fine, and she does something else, and I'm talking in Finnish to my newborn baby, one day old. And the midwife tells me, don't do that, you confuse the child. There's no way, you know, don't do that. So there are many professions who send these messages that somehow bilingualism isn't accepted. Your point before the war, particularly families, I read about them, and I read a brilliant book just recently about what language do I dream in, that described a family like you were saying, you know, grandparents spoke Russian, then they moved to Prague, so they learned to speak, the children learned to go to school and learned to speak Czech, then they moved to Germany, they spoke to German, and they were Jewish, they also spoke Yiddish. So they had four languages, no problem. Why do we now then have this notion that bilingualism isn't very good? Whereas before, like you were saying, you know, different generations accepted it as normal. And I think the answers are slightly different in different places. Depends how the schools have responded to the different languages and what the policy has been in the place and how much the schooling has become about test results rather than learning. I don't know. Have you got an answer yourself to that question?
I remember that when we started our studies, we had a girl from Austria. Do you remember? And she was doing her research on bilingualism, and she found that in Austrian system, the children could only put on the computer that they speak German only. And if they speak other language, and she was Italian as far as I remember, she couldn't say that it was a good thing. So it was exactly state policy, exactly. Even in computer, it was put against bilingualism. And for me, it was really surprising because for me, two languages and three and four are always an asset. Yes. I don't know if this may be personal, but and I think that in Poland, we still believe it is an asset. Yes, I think so.
Yes, good. Maybe that's something we can work around tomorrow and on Friday as well, about these differences. Very interesting for me to hear what's happened in Poland and how it's received in Hungary and wherever else in Poland. Okay, so traditional idea of language is of course a very much an ideological construct, but as such it is a very, very powerful idea. So in schools in England, for example, it works to think about English as the pure language that we want to teach our next generation. We pass on the best of our culture and what we know to the next one. So it works in that sense. But the notion of identifying the human speech as national languages, giving them names like, well, there are lots of examples. Roma languages are, for example, a good example. Really emerged around the 19th century at the time of when the nation state was developed, nation states were developed. And it's very much meshed with the need to differentiate between people. So if we identify a nation, say like Finland, got its independence only 100 years ago. So this is us in Finland. And therefore, it is for us who speak Finnish. Now, if you speak something else, then you're not quite so much Finnish as the ones that speak Finnish. It was a way of showing who belongs to this space and this nationhood. So, in the course of the 19th century, most, if not all, European nation states used national languages to trigger unity and assess loyalty. But what that led to is that, of course, then in schools, this idea of monolingualism took hold. It was seen as the natural norm that we speak this language and that it's somehow definable as a unit of language that remains the same, although none of the languages remain the same. and that therefore multiculturalism or bilingualism or multilingualism is disturbing or even threatening. So this monolingual habitus, if you work with the Bourdieu's ideas, is still very much prevalent in European schools. But it's that disturbing factor that drives me in my work, that why is it that some children's context, their multilingualism is seen as a problem for schools? Why is it disturbing and a problem, whereas one language isn't seen a problem? You would think that the Polish situation would prevail, but it doesn't.
For the whole time while you are talking about this thing, I'm constantly thinking about the painting by Bruegel about the Tower of the Babel, because we all were taught early, from the very early, and the story from the Bible, and I think it's very often repeated. Yes, that the multilingualism was sent as a punishment, yes, on all other people, so they couldn't work together. And I think that it is in fact put into everybody from the very childhood, idea.
So the Tower of Babel was destroyed because people have become so deviant that they spoke so many different languages. Now, what does that smack of? It smacks of control, doesn't it? Somebody's there saying, I'm losing control because you people are making business in your own languages in different ways. Somebody then says, I've got to yank you back and identify one language, or at least few, that we can control. You lot, who are often poor, you're smelly, don't seem to be producing as much as others. Particularly your way of speaking, we don't want to know. So I think you're absolutely right that it's got a long history of seeing multilingualism as disturbing. So language status, you probably can't see it, but so if you think about the world's languages. So we said there are just over 7,000 world languages in the world. So the local vernacular languages is about 6,000 of them. They're the local vernaculars, the ones that don't often have a written form. On top of that, then there are the official languages within nation states. There are around 600 languages worldwide that are official, institutionalized languages. Then there are nationalized. Remember, many places in the world, of course, have two or three or four institutionalized languages. What is it in Poland? You can work in Polish, can you work in Russian still?
No. Just Polish.
Just Polish.
We are mono in everything, mono.
Excellent.
Not English. Not English, that's why.
No. It's not official.
So in Finland, official languages of Finland is Finnish. Swedish, because 5% of Finnish people speak Finnish, from the old colonial times when Finland belonged to Sweden. The first language that the people around the geographical area who lived there first are the Sami. They are the nomadic people who now inhabit the northern Finland, Sweden, Norway, and northern Russia. And they were the reindeer herders. They were nomadic, they moved along with their reindeer herds as the seasons changed. So they came towards south in the winter, and then in the summer they moved back to, with the snow withdrawing it. And sign language is another national language of Finland, as is Gar Romani dialects.
Okay.
Then there are regional languages. In many countries there are many regional languages. And then there are the big languages, English and French. So if you think most of the world's people who speak these languages, it is interesting how many of the world's population receive their education in English and French. And we should put there, this was one particular, about one language context, but what should go there is of course Spanish and Mandarin Chinese into that official, the big languages. Okay, but what we've known through research and work is that the valorizing school language at the expense of home language tends to leave to cognitive disadvantages and subtractive bilingualism. So schools have been for decades now making a case of, yes, we value your home language, but that's on the policy, that's on the piece of paper, that's what the teachers might have in their teachers' rooms and in official documents. But what happens in practice, that the child who brings another language to school doesn't feel that the school values it. So it leads to lack of motivation, lack of interest, but also the child enough to work on this big project on Roma children, particularly in England, but also in three other countries in Europe. Now, is this something that you all are familiar with? Can I rush through these slides? Do you know about Roma and their history and their languages? Yes? Yeah? No?
Thomas.
Yes, I remember seeing that on the website. Excellent. Well, you can see if I'm correct me in my more interesting things to say. So the largest minority ethnic group in whole of Europe is actually Roman. And yet it is not the biggest. All from this winter. And then after, as soon as Christmas is over, we forget that.
Okay, that's the language. Yeah.
So just a point about the fact that although we talk about them as gypsies, they're not from Egypt, like many people believed long time ago. Many Roma people have slightly darker hair, skin color, and therefore they located them in Egypt. They thought they were Egyptians, and that's where the English word gypsy comes from Egyptian. And it wasn't until in 1782 when this researcher published his work, recognizing that actually they can't be from Egypt, because in the language that they speak, it is so similar in many ways to Hindi and Urdu that it has to be related to some of the Indian languages. And therefore, maybe the people must have come from India rather than Egypt. So around 500 AD or before, they lived somewhere around central India, and then they moved on towards the north around 500 to 800 AD. There are various thoughts been put forward why they made that move. And it's always interesting with any group of people, why did they? And there are different kind of schools of thought. Some people say that they perhaps were already then oppressed, that they fled the oppression. Others say that their professions were often related. to moving around and selling things or making things or working with people. So that was the reason why they moved, rather than an oppression. Or maybe just a combination of many factors. They settled initially around sort of what we now know as Greece and Turkey, and then when the Turkish army started to invade that bit, they fled to different parts of Europe. Ended up in England, in Finland, and so on. And of course they have suffered from persecution for centuries. Some interesting observations from Northern Europe in 1740-1780, when their rights to own a horse and a wagon was taken away. So then you cannot travel anymore, take away. You can't really work either if your work relates to moving about and selling your goods or your services. But more sort of sinister and more troubling was this idea that they were prohibited to marry each other. There was a notion of that if they can't produce more babies, then the ethnic groups will die out. And of course, they also prohibited the wearing of traditional Romani clothing and the use of Romani language. Holocaust, I don't need to talk, but they were also put in the concentration camp along with many other groups. Jewish people, of course, being the biggest group, but with gays and lesbians and Jehovah's Witnesses, I think. But we're not quite sure of the figures because we didn't have accurate pre-war figures, but we do know that it was a sizable group of European Roma that died in the concentration camps. So the poverty that is so much associated still with Roma is interesting. And this is again Tinka. I took this photograph just last summer in Tinka. Tinka is a little village where in the center of the village you have Romanians and a school there, and there's a church and shops and a little marketplace and so on. On the outskirts there are this Roma camp. Although it's not camp anymore, but it is a village. It's full of houses where they have lived now for generations. But they are illegal in the sense that they don't own the land. They have never got a permission to build a house there. Yet as the families grow, generations grow, changes, they often might build another one here and another one there, whilst those maybe get to run down and are pulled down and so on. So there is a bit of movement between the houses too. But it is illegal. There is some electricity going on, and sometimes some houses, you can see them illegally pulling the electricity from the wires into their houses. No sewage system yet, no water, so you see people going to the well and bringing water back to their houses. This is Europe in 2007. But because it's illegal, they don't have an address. So if you go and try to do something about your situation and you apply for a job, they say, so where do you live? You haven't got an address to live. It's very difficult to get a job. Even if you get a job and then try to get a salary that your employer pays you once a month, you go to the bank and say, I want to open a bank account. And of course you can't, because you need an address to open a bank account. So the system of oppression is seriously deeply rooted in this area. And it's not the only area. So what we have then, coming back to the language issue, is this story of waste, of potential that could be realized in different ways, but has not been. comes now from England, Department of Education 2015, and these are the kinds of exam results that we publish every year in England. So these are children who level 4 means at the age of 11, just when they're leaving primary school and moving to secondary school, they take a national test, and it's the same test for everybody. The percentage of children achieving that level 4 test in reading, writing and maths, the national average is 80%. Now the highest performing ethnic group is Chinese in Britain. The second is Indian, then white, Asian, Irish, any other background, and so forth. And here we have 30% of Roma children in England in 2015 got, after primary school, level 4. If you look what happens then when they go to secondary school, at the end of the secondary school, at the age of 16, they take the test GCSE, and whereas A to C is the aspired, or we think that everybody should get at least English, maths and science in A to C, this is what the data then shows. The blue one is 2007 and 2008, and the red one is 2011 and 2012. So you can see how Chinese from 2007 and 8 to 11 and 12 got even higher, as did Indian and so did others. And here you have, again, the traveller of Irish heritage, Gypsy and Roma. It's a big group of pupils that is actually quite problematic to put them all in one group. But nevertheless, we see that the improvement is not that great compared to many other groups. So other groups with teachers are managing to get better results. So the achievement of some minority ethnic groups, some linguistic minorities, is going up. But the speed of which Roma children's achievement goes up is much slower. But some improvement.
Can I have a question? Because you have here travelers, and I remember that we read an article by Gobo for our Brno school. In this article, it was written that they travel a lot. It was suggested that children go to different schools, but in 1 year they can go to 3 or even 4 schools. In fact, this is what the lady who did this ethnographic research suggested, that this was one of the reasons why they had poor results at school. Because of this constant
change,
yes. And I am just curious if you, if it is also included in this kind of statistics, yeah?
Yeah.
Because if it is only the language, or do they also think about other elements,
like moving around?
Yes, exactly.
Yes.
Changing school
attendance.
Yes. School attendance.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But this is also another perspective, is that they are not able to learn where they are.
Mm-hmm.
The system does not see the possibility for them to stay in the community and learn in the community as they travel.
That's how,
right?
That
they have
start
to come
from, the beginning,
from school,
yes,
to school, and then they
mm-hmm.
measure them and they say that they perform poorly.
Yes. So we call them travelers, and we call them Gypsy Roma traveler children. And we put them a lot together. Some of them are Irish travellers, some are Scottish travellers, some are the New Age hippie travellers, and so on. They're all put together. The truth of the fact of that group, though, is that only 10% travel.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. That question. And I'll come back to that in a minute as well. But after that, getting the ethnic group sorted, then people do very close analysis, careful analysis. Could it be because they're moving around? Could it be about unemployment in that area? Could it be about parents' level of education? Could it be also, could it be that a bigger number of these children are in care, in sort of orphanages, or, you know, they just kind of try to work out more reasons. This just gives you one bit of the fact. But interestingly, of course, the very same story is told all over Europe. This is now from Bulgaria, Czech Republic, Hungary, Romania, and Slovak Republic, about the early going to schools, going to accessing preschool education. And again, Roma is blue and non-Roma is orange. And you can see that from the very early stages, they access school far less than others. So this same old story of lost potential seems to be taking place everywhere, including Finland. This is my colleague Fred Durbin from Helsinki University talking about Finnish Roma in Finland. And I don't know if you've seen those constant news items, how Finnish education system is the best. Yes, some people are not. I mean, I don't know why anybody would think there is such a thing as the best. What is that all about?
Freedom.
The best? We don't know.
Freedom.
No.
Right?
Yeah.
Democratic education system.
And no dropouts.
No
dropouts from the system.
That's rubbish.
This
no,
is
no,
rubbish.
No,
that's
what no,
it is.
No,
good because you even Finnish can explain why. This is why everybody is so excited about this.
There's a huge problem with boys drop out in Finland.
Yeah.
They disappear from statistics, actually, around the age of 17, and we don't know where they've gone.
Yeah.
They're not in work, they're not in education, they don't seem to be living anywhere. So are they living in their parents' back room or being, what is it? So I'm telling you, there's no such thing as a best system, education system. There could be, but I don't think it's been.
Recently, I've just seen an article. There is an author called Nicola Kaki. Is she Finnish at your journal? I don't know.
Maria Nicola Kaki. No, she's Greek.
She's Greek. Okay, so maybe it wasn't she, but somebody wrote that being the best meant or acted like, as they wrote, a Trojan horse for neoliberal policies, because, you know, they are the best, now we have to support them becoming, you know,
yeah,
all in the
yeah
measurement. So it is like a counterpunch from the system. Oh, you are the best, then you
absolutely
have to follow.
And it works, doesn't it? Certainly in England,
yeah,
it's great to be talking, but in Finland they do it differently.
Mm.
It's great they don't test them every year,
mm,
and they don't put them under pressure. It's wonderful to have a system that works without that. But that's not to say that it's the best.
No.
By whose definition? Does that always stay the same? Does it mean it's best for all groups of children? Because from 1950s to 1980s, every third of Roma children was taken into care. Every third. And they said it was because they lived in such poor conditions. So it was bad for children to live in poor conditions. So rather than doing something about the conditions, they yanked every third child into orphanages and institutions. If you were born in 75, you might be having children of your own now, mightn't you? Would you trust teachers and social workers and police if in your ethnic group every third had grown up in an institution? I don't think I would. Anyway, the same old story today. Roma today, when they are the best system in the world, they are often placed in special educational classes without any diagnosis. They don't report that one, they do. Okay, here as she said, they are put with diagnosis. They're put into special education with the diagnosis.
Also, there's a good language issue that the
okay. So my worry is this global story of lost potential and what to do. What do you do about it then in different places? So I'm not interested in fixing Roma children. Here are some from the project in France, outside their squat where they live, where they invited us to see where their homes and talk to us. So I don't think Roma children need to be fixed. I don't think there's anything wrong with them. And I don't think it's something that we should celebrate. Like occasionally in England we have this Gypsy Roma month or week when we celebrate their culture. I don't think that's right either. I think we want to fix the system that actually positions some children so negatively and marginalizes them. So remember I said early on, imposing sort of these dominant languages to children in schools, and I said, so let's come back to this, what are our alternatives? So one of my life work has been around this issue that if you have these children who speak another language at home, putting them in a separate class away from other children that go to school doesn't work. Neither do these policies of assimilation work either. And this is, of course, what the best system in the world currently does then, Finland. They don't put new arriving children in the same school with everybody else. They create a different class, and often it's in a different place, so they bus the children. This is Syrians, this is Somalis, this is Russians, this is Polish maybe, there's English kids there, absolutely, although far fewer English, of course, bussed into this school where they then are in the same class from 7 to 14 years. And they are in that class for one whole year until teachers feel that now they can go to the proper school. And what happens during that 1 year, of course, is that you take on board that somehow I'm not quite so good for this system as others. So I think that we should by now really begin to focus on the cognitive benefits of bilingualism and begin to organize our you can have a class of 30 and 25 different languages in one class. Here is one case study that I did from a nursery school. These are four-year-olds, and these were in one group in one morning. This was what the school reported that the children spoke. So six were English speakers, and so on. Romanian, Turkish, Portuguese, Arabic, Polish, Farsi, Urdu, Bulgarian, Punjabi, Creole, Chinese, Mandarin, and Albanian. Okay, so one group. But, you know, beyond that, it gets even more complicated. Because this is Leila, who was introduced to me as an Albanian speaker. When I talked to Leila's mother, she said that actually, well, yes, I'm from Albania, and I've been in England now for 15 years, but Daddy is from Somalia. But when they came from after the Civil War, they actually went to Finland, so he actually learned to Finnish. So he speaks Finnish and Somalian. They are two languages. And so now we have Somalian, Finnish, Albanian, and some Arabic, because they are also Muslims and they want to learn to read the classical Arabic for Quranic purposes, Quran reading of the Quran. And they said, we always use English together. So what is Leila's first language? What is Leila's mother tongue? What is Leila's own language? What is Leila's family language? These terms are really difficult. And I am in a process of trying to find a term that would capture all of that. So maybe I will start using language. trying to say mother tongue or first language. I don't know. Anyway, so there's Lena. Here are those speed of which more and more British children have learned or are using, the speed of which more and more languages are spoken at home by children in primary and secondary schools. So in 1997, we had 500,000 children who spoke another language other than English at home. And by 2012, it had gone to 1 million. And then now it's gone above 1 million. So that's the size of it. It's multilingualism, plurilingualism, is very much the way education should be, what education should be focusing on. But also, I think it's very, very exciting. So also, just a point about Polish being our biggest minority, linguistic minority at the moment. So more children speak Polish than any other language. It's the biggest group of minority
Not for long anymore. Not for long. I think I've got that.
Okay, and then of course the more again serious matter that. World has got even more complicated recently. We've got over 60 million people forcibly displaced. So Great Britain hasn't been very good at taking recent refugees. I think, 10,000 we've taken in the last couple of years or something, where Sweden took 100,000 migrants, refugees. Okay. What we know about the cognitive benefits of multilingualism is that there are positive links found in proficiency and more language, more than one language and cognitive academic skills. And some studies indicate that bilingual speakers are more creative and better at solving complex problems. And then there's more, we've got lots and lots of studies from all over the world. So here is Raymond Sneddon in London finding that those children who used routinely three languages in schools in addition to English began to outperform monolingual children. Jim Cummings' work from Canada showed that bilingual children perform better in school when the school effectively teaches mother tongue. So effectively organizes classes in mother tongue. Now, you can do that in some areas where you've got many speakers of the same language. So we've got North London, there's an area where we've got lots of Turkish and Greek speakers. So there you could do bilingual Greek and Turkish and English. But of course, then you have these classes where you've got the 24 languages. Mm-hmm. What are you going to do there? This is an interesting study from the United States that proved conclusively that bilingual education in California brought about better results for all children than monolingual schools. So these were in California in the 80s, where they followed children for 12 years, and in the bilingual schools where children were learning half the lessons in Spanish and half the lessons in English, both groups reached the top grades after 12 years. So that meant that the Spanish children actually overtook the English-speaking children. Their results were the highest of the whole group. But the English-speaking was kind of, whatever you call them, sort of ordinary American monolingual English-speaking kids. Their levels, too, had gone up from other high levels of monolingual schools. So bilingual school brought about advantages for both groups, the Spanish, the Latina children, and monolingual English. A teacher t- teaching the children and 50% of the English-speaking teacher teaching, because we don't have the Roma speakers in the area. So we couldn't do it like that. And we can't do that approach in many schools anyway. So we had to find a different approach. So the aims of the project was really then to synthesize the teachers' pedagogical knowledge with parents' and pupils' linguistic knowledge. We wanted the Roma parents to draw on their linguistic funds of knowledge and support the teachers in order to empower teachers to develop better relationships with Roma families. We often hear that teachers say that the Roma parents, they don't really value education. They're not really interested. They rather travel or they just do something else. And of course, that isn't true when you meet the Roma families. That's not what they ever tell you. So we wanted the teachers to develop these better relationships with their families. And we most importantly wanted to change the power dynamics of the school and family relationships. So the context in which we developed the project were these. So Tinka, I talked to you about Järvenpää in Finland, where they began to make very cheaply resources that could be used bilingually. We had a school in Montpellier in France, where the teachers developed museum visits and parents worked as translators. But I'm going to talk to you about this most exciting bit, this one in Newcastle. We developed this very strange-looking space in one school. And I'm not at all saying that everybody now has to develop this amazing technological space. That's not what this project was about. It was developing something really high status to show the Roma community that we're developing the best we can for your community, and then we're drawing principles from that to be used with slightly less expensive technologies. So that we call that translanguage and inquiry learning space. I know it looks like something from a hospital, but it actually becomes alive when the children do. So this is it. So we have these curtains are pulled around, so it's a closed space, and we pull some, what are these things, where you can, the projectors can project videos. Then there's a camera that captures what the children are doing. We've got a smart table, which is an interactive smart table, a bit like interactive smart boards are, but it's on a table, and we develop different tools, and all the sound files were then translated and acted out by parents. Now, all of this intellectual property then is now available from our website. We are about to finish the project. It really finishes in writing the outputs in the next couple of weeks. And it is all available from the project. So then we develop these inquiries that children will do in the space when they go with teachers. And on the screens then we project films that were specifically made for this project. So one is, for example, they're investigating the Great Fire of Newcastle, and they're given the role of the fire investigator. And here, five children, 9 to 10 year olds, are studying ancient Baghdad, and they've been given the role of history investigators. So the context is normal, ordinary, everyday curriculum. It's what you would be teaching anyway to any group of children. But they are doing it through an inquiry. They do a series of tasks. So, for example, when they are being the fire investigator, which of course is a woman, of course, rather than a man, the investigator says, "Hello, children. I'm the chief fire investigator working in Newcastle, and I need your help." As soon as she said that, she says the same in Romani, in the Roma language that we identified as being spoken by that community in that school. So the technology does that. Now the character speaks in two languages. Says it first in English and first then in East Slovak Romani dialect, which is what they identified. The very first time we did that with six-year-olds, there was a little girl there listening to it. And when she heard her own language, she turned to the teacher and said, Miss, that is my English. Because she had no words to describe. Nobody's ever really talked about languages in home languages in the ordinary school learning situation. So we're bringing the languages in all sorts of ways into ordinary teaching situations. So there's lots of problems that they have to resolve. So a lot of the work that children do there depends on talk, on interaction with each other. So, for example, the older children, when they go to Baghdad, then as soon as they are flying to it, and the beauty of these films is that when they sit there in that space, then it feels like they're flying, because we're projecting a video that looks like the view is moving from an aeroplane. You're at the airport and now you're beginning to see ground and now you're in the clouds. And then it lands. So even if you don't understand much English, you have a sense that we've perhaps gone somewhere high up and now we're flying and we go down. Then they arrive in Baghdad, but there is suddenly a big demonstration. And everyone is saying that, I cannot bring this object to you, it belongs here. What to do, says the character, and translates it, says the same thing in East Slovak dialect. So we haven't sanitized any of this. So if you go on archaeological dig in Baghdad, is it right that the British then bring the artifacts back to England? So the children get to debate about this at the age of 9 and 10. And decide what is right and what they should do. Should they or shouldn't they? So they go and work through these. And of course, it was their parents that did the translation, which was an amazing thing. Because when they're listening to those characters, they don't recognize that it's my dad who's speaking. They had no idea. They so got into the inquiry and the world of ancient Baghdad that they never figured out that one particular girl, for example, I'm thinking of, she never realized that it was her dad speaking it. Amazing. So they worked in groups, not exclusively so that Roma work on their own, but everybody worked together, English speakers and Roma speakers. And of course, there were lots of other speakers. There were Somalis, there were Bulgarians, there was one Estonian, and so on. All sorts, all to work together. So what they're then beginning to do, they're beginning to use their own home language in the context of learning history, in the context of learning writing, reading, and so on. And our early analysis, we haven't finished it yet, but the interaction in the lessons really is full of joy. I think that there's lots of moments like that when they are really tuned into the problem that they have to resolve, and they got to talk about it, and they can talk in both languages. So lots of joy. They did take much longer terms in English with more diverse vocabulary. When a teacher who came to watch them in there said that, I have never seen this child in all the 6 months that the child has been in my class, I never knew that the child knows so much. So suddenly the teachers began to see the children as capable learners, as using their cognitive resources more evenly than just using English. So they negotiated word meanings, and that's, there's some hilarious bits that I hope to show you maybe tomorrow or on Friday. Much conceptual transfer from one language to another, and deeper engagement with subject content. It also really transformed some of the parent-teacher relationships. Teachers wanted to learn from the parents. They couldn't create those inquiries if the parents didn't come to school to translate. The parents loved that translating so much that one dad didn't go to work on one day and gave up one day's salary just to come to record and translate these videos. Now that is somebody who cares about education, who is not difficult to reach. And in doing so, the school developed symbiotic relationships between families and teachers and moved away from this kind of one-way collaboration, you know, where teachers say that they work together with parents, but actually they meet the parents and they tell, do it like this, change the way you do, become somebody else.
And who designed this symbiote?
The teachers.
The teachers.
Teachers. Together with us, with the team, but mostly themselves. And then we worked with people who, we had a research assistant who could draw cartoon characters, and then the technology department told us kind of what we need to think when we develop these videos. We got amazing stuff from other places. So, the human rights perspective, I think, is that really that if we want to maintain whatever way we look at our world today, the strongest systems are always the most diverse. So they are most resilient to problems in the world. So I think language and cultural diversity maximizes the chances of human success. So I'm going to just stop there. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lana. And these questions, comments?
I have a comment or a question. I was graciously given a subject to teach at the university here. It's called Bilingual Education of Teachers who can teach in kindergarten. And I knew from the beginning that I would do it from a very critical perspective, and I invited a teacher who taught in American school here in Wrocław, and she just told the students, you know, how oppressive this method was and how they had to cheat the owner, the teachers, because the, like a 3 or 2 year old cried, and the teachers were supposed to speak only in English to the children, not in their native languages, although some people could communicate in different languages, the kids were from different countries. And I just, wonder, and there is this Krill now, in, I don't know if you heard about this, but it's very much promoted in European Union, especially through Erasmus project, and this was actually this class was mostly supposed to be promoting Krill, as from what I saw from the previous schedule that I received. So, well, it's not a question. It's mainly just a comment that. With this clear thing they created, it's a content and language learning, but it's integrated learning. That's why the abbreviation is clear. So we create, in order to to make it, you know, sound nice and in order just to promote it, we just think out of those strange names as if, you know, whatever you teach is not cannot be, I don't know, mixed with content and language. It has to, right?
Yes.
So this clear thing is a new phenomenon promoted for the last 10 years, I think, and as I said, you know, here it became a subject, a class.
Yes, yes.
So,
yes.
It's just a comment, I don't know.
Yes.
Not a question.
Yeah,
but
A lot of the what is going on in terms of promoting bilingual education rests on the idea that you don't mix, you see. There's this notion that mixing is bad, because then these pure languages don't remain so pure and you learn a more mixed sort of a local vernacular or local sort of a pigeonized version of that language. Whereas we, Garthia is one who first, although it was more in Wales first, talks about translanguaging. That it's not about code switching from this to this, but actually using the both in a way that feels natural to you. Since we cannot organize those bilingual lessons in two or three different languages, what we're advocating, and other people who work on this translanguaging idea, is that you allow children to use whatever resources they've got. So if you are confident in three languages, you could have a context where you can confidently switch and mix and match as you approach that topic. Whereas a lot of people still feel that it's somehow sits uncomfortably with what teachers were told, perhaps when they trained or
business as this school actually probably is, I don't know it from exactly, but as the owner imagines the education should look like. So
yes,
a 3-year
yes.
old wants to go to the toilet screaming or just a fright,
yes.
And cannot be comforted in his or her own language. And it's
yes,
just pure oppression.
Sort of immersion programs, and is that what it is? Yes, yeah.
I have just a short comment maybe about the English hegemony. As an English speaker, we are always expected to teach grammar in English, which everybody hated. Yes? And it really didn't make any sense. So I never teach grammar in English because I think it's stupid. First of all, people should understand. Yes? And thanks to God, now the general idea, global idea, is to teach grammar in native language. So this is the end of, at least in this part of the hegemony.
Yes.
And let's say it is officially said that you can teach the difficult things in native language.
I was just going to ask, it only refers to spoken languages, right? Because also there is a bunch of sign languages which are also even
languages.
Languages.
But you could bring in sign language. And I mean, actually, many, many earliest settings or nursery schools or in England do sign. The mechanism is there, it's sort of simplified English sign language, which they use first, often, to complement their spoken. And they find that all children benefit from this, not just those who just maybe learning English.
But with sign language, it is actually it's artificial and more natural one. What they're implementing is the official language, not the real one, which is also an oppression. As my friends, the deaf, they just say, you know, they don't understand what you are saying.
It's
official. Have, like, official sign language, and then this non-official, which is Polish sign language, and they differ.
Yes.
And for example, in TV, those programs are translated with this
official
language, which is not
understood
by most of
them. Yes. And of course, a lot of these Roma languages don't have a written form, because they, or at least parents don't know, the families don't know that.
So that's another issue, that of course it's great when you've got books to draw upon. And, but I mean, we've not found it difficult for children to write in their Roman dialect, in their Roman language, even if that doesn't have a recognised written form by the families. They just start writing as if it was English. You know, they just use the phonetics of English language and phonics, phonic knowledge of the letter sound relationship.
But you said the Roman language doesn't have a written form. I didn't know that.
No, it does.
It does,
but not right. There are many, many so complicated forms of Roman languages, because of the history of their migration.
Mm-hmm.
So they've often accrued words and aspects of that language wherever that group has gone. So they're quite varied. And some forms, and indeed in Romania and I think in Bulgaria, they're promoting this one Romani alphabet and a Romani written system now. But it is a bit different from the Romani or the Roma languages that other groups speak. So it's a very contested and sort of issue at the moment. What should you standardize all the Roma languages and dialects and promote one, or should you allow for,
why should we standardize everything? That's the question.
Yeah.
I just wonder that you have this kind of debates with Dave, like that, you know, it we can, I think I can say that it is not a classical Marxist research, you know. Yes, it's more like this, what Dave identified as this social democratic, you know, we have to reformulate a bit the school and introduce like new techniques, and then we can bring on the some changes and so on. So how would you reflect on it? Because you know what strikes me very much is that when you, and you are right, when you ask a gypsy family, you know, they tell you the Western idea that yes, education is the promise for the social mobility, even if it is not true, especially for them.
It's not. Yeah.
They know it for centuries that education does shit nothing for them, but they still believe, just like us, that education is the non plus ultra promise for the future and so on, which is a fate. And I think we don't face it, that it's a fate, but you know, they still don't.
Mm. You know what Apple would say? That only Apple, yeah, Michael Apple, he would say only that the right believe in education, and because education rules the world and they achieve their hidden curriculum. So you've got to believe if you want to be like this.
I think it's important. I think it's critically important for such a thing, because you know, I also do the same, and I face the same dilemma that still, of course, who would be so stupid to say that Roma children has no place in the school? I say that yes, they shouldn't be in segregated class, they should be in inclusive schools and so on, but does it really bring on anything?
I agree, and yes, we do loads of debates. We can share those maybe later tomorrow or Friday, but
we have fundamental disagreements.
Yes.
But we have fundamental agreements as well.
And it really helps us to kind of clarify our positions. So, okay, so two things there that strikes me is that it is wrong to say that education is a way to a better life, maybe today.
Mm-hmm.
That the statistics and what we understand from groups is that that isn't the way. It doesn't seem to be true anymore. That aside, learning to read, learning to write, learning what the school can offer, working in a group when you are a child, I think that is important, hugely important to those groups. That's where I'm going to stop.
That's Vygotsky. Vygotsky, what you say, and I was thinking about that. He said Marxism. Maybe he can't see Marxism, no change in the techniques and tools, but in the brain, I think there is a complete change for these children. So their Marxism is in their heads.
And then, you see, they have to go to school.
school in England.
They have to. They can't not go. They try not to, but there's all sorts of penalties that now, you know, kind of people are, they come and look at the books. So if they go to school, what are you going to do with them? You've got to do the best you can, don't you?
I know.
You have to make schools better, not just yes. Avoid them.
No,
I'm
on the opposite side.
It's statistics.
Yeah.
But you already benefited from everything that you gained from school.
This is why I hate it so much.
Thank you.
I
will be coming tomorrow. See you tomorrow.